he's being an ideologist. His question, the first question that he has asked himself when he started to deal with what he calls foreign religion, was came about because of his, well, being exposed to foreign, what he calls foreign religiosity. And therefore, I think this is quite appropriate that I present his attitude during our meeting. So his transcendental hermeneutics of religion rose or was inspired by the fact that he was exposed to what he calls a foreign religiosity, and also he was exposed as a person quite aware of his own religious affiliation, which is Catholicism, and this I would also like stress, because he never denies it, though he never says it openly in his writings. But still, I think that it is important to say that he is a Catholic in his religious background. So in 1988, in an interview for the magazine Das Fenster, Oppenheimer explained the approach to religion in the following manner. According to me, his approach to religion and the way he wants to interpret it. According to me, hermeneutics is an attempt to interpret the phenomenon of religion, not, however, in the sense of... Sorry, this should be already here. Yeah. Not, however, in the sense of the theological understanding of what religion is, but in the sense of religion as a human phenomenon, unrestricted by dogmatic positions. Why does man have religion? In what does the essence of religion lie? And further he added, in my view, hermeneutics is a scholarly investigation of the understanding of not only the text, but also the phenomenon. So in the interview, further on, Oppenheimer refers to the system of the transcendental hermeneutics of religion as related to the question of how to approach methodologically human religiosity given the multiplicity of doctrines and beliefs. This question became vital for him already in 1957 when he during his first encounter with India, both as a scholar, as I told you at the beginning, and a practicing Catholic. So Oppenheimer spoke of experiencing foreign religiosity as crucial for his academic and intellectual formation. It is then that he asked himself the following questions. How one should find access to this current religion without modifying one's own principles, one's own worldview, one's own religion? So he comes out from a clearly defined standpoint, showing that here we have a person, a believer, talking about foreign religion. The question was more and more decisive for my work, not only in the field of research, but also existentially for the development of my entire spirituality. And what happens when man not only has religion, but lives it? In this intimate condition, there is expressed a sincere concern of a philosopher and a practicing believer, who is confronted with and exposed to the foreign forms of religion, but who also attempts to critically and rationally examine the problem without relativizing the validity of his own faith. It therefore seems to that the initial stimulus for positioning Oppenheimer's hermeneutical reflection on religion lies primarily within the existential context, and it was a particular situation of being exposed to a foreign form of religiosity. In the present times of growing tension over religious issues, it seems important to emphasize this aspect of the otherwise rather highly theoretical approach. The method defined by its author as transcendental hermeneutics of religion was developed systematically over the years, more than 20 certainly, and always showed a sympathetic and sensitive interpretation of foreign forms of faith. It also became conducive to the analysis and interpretation of religiosity in which men and the process of living religion, that is, of existentially experiencing it, constitute the core of inquiry and the center of interpretation. Questions which Oppenheimer posed in his interview, simple as they may seem, may be simplifying also, Why does man have religion? In what does the essence of religion lie? What happens when a man not only has religion, but also lives it? Have always remained in the background of Adorno's theoretical reflection, and thereby situating in the sphere of existential ontological approach. Since I was told to be short in my presentation, I will speak a little bit about the background, the historical background of his discussion and the very name of his system, the transcendental hermeneutics of religion, except for one person, because Oberhammer refers his work and his ideas and relates them to the thought of Karl Rahner, a Catholic theologian and philosopher as well, from Austria. When discussing the structure of the cognizing subject, cognitive act and cognition as such, Rahner mentions the following. Subjective, automatic, and present in every act of cognition, necessary and non-abrogable power consciousness of the knowing subject, and the openness to the unlimited scope of every possible reality is called the transcendental experience. This experience is called transcendental because it belongs to the necessary, non-abrogable structure of the knowing subject, and because it consists of precisely going beyond a certain group of possible objects, going beyond a category. So behind it there is a rather clear that presupposition that Rahner makes in his idea about the act, the transcendental experience, which shows that there is something like the openness of the knowing subject and how the act of cognition arises due to this fact. So the subject's openness is a necessary programmatic condition of every cognitive act, and in that regard it is related, of course, to the understanding question. Oberhammer, though inspired by this idea of this subject's openness, conceptualizes the ultimate openness of the subjects by Sichsein, that is self-presence, self-awareness, differently. He emphasizes the fact that it is the ontic dimension or ontic conditioning, which is both prior, if not a priori, and primary to the transcendentality of consciousness. So therefore we have this transcendental hermeneutics of religion. I'll skip some of it. So, the question which Oberhammer wants to ask is basically how man becomes a homo religiosus. And the attempts to answer questions are necessarily undertaken from the perspective of an individual person. So Oberhammer's central thesis is that it is human being who is the locus of revelation. So in his system of her religious hermeneutics, the core of religion is the way in which a human person substantiates it in the encounter with transcendence. So the postulate of the transcendentality of consciousness of the human being constitutes an important point of departure for his reflection. His inquiry into the phenomenological structure of any act of communication led him to conclude the following.
Sorry to distract you with my vain attempts.
Anyway, so he says, should one think about consciousness as an inwardness, inamicrate, of self-presence, by Sichsein, of the human being, then transcendence as the a priori of the intellect in every mental act must be invariant. So from this point of departure, he then develops the metaphysics of his hermeneutical approach to religion, and in this approach there are two notions which are basic for him, One is methanization, I'm sorry for the translation, rather lame translation in English, but there is no other way. And metazirok, and encounter, again, in the phenomenological analysis of the experience of transcendence. So trying to describe the process of experiencing what he also calls not transcendence or transcendentality, but the beyond being, also avoiding connotations of any kind of, civilizational or cultural conditioning, he introduces the two notions, that is the concept of methanization and encounter. What are the functions and roles, their functions and roles in the event of experiencing transcendence? The very need for the idea of methanization can be traced back to the old problem of the experience of transcendence. It is presupposed, as Oberhammer says, that every religious tradition is based on the true experience of transcendence, or rather the experience of the beyond being in this vocabulary. There arise some basic doubts regarding the matter. How is it possible that there are so many different ways of experiencing it? How is it possible that different religious traditions rooted in different ways of experiencing transcendence claim their undisputable validity? This is the point at which the idea of methanization as a condition of variegated experiences of transcendence enters all the harmless hermeneutics of religion. So, here it is. Methanization occurs in addressing the reality, Robert. And this addressing man has to execute in order to have the world, so that in this having the world, he would be immediate to the reality. Functional mechanization would be understood as the framework of expectation, and then, if meant as such, it becomes subsumable under the category of framework of experience. Let us consider the connotations of this abstract definition. First of all, what does addressing the reality mean? It is turning inwards, in Oberhammer's words, it's turning towards a particular entity, and this turning towards is structured by an underlying anticipation that this and not any other entity will be present to the subject. This particular constituting of the subject's expectation is not yet filled with any specific content of his awareness regarding the to be experienced thing. The subject nonetheless expects that there is going to arise the possibility of experiencing this one thing. Without a prospect as to what is to be experienced, it will be impossible for the subject to confront the awaiting reality in such a manner that the very experience will be meaningful or would have a meaningful content. Or else, in Oberhammer words, that the subject has appropriates this reality. So this addressing or turning towards the object of experience is an important point of departure for further detailed considerations connected to methanization. So it should be rather understood as a pre-logical, pre-conceptual, and internally developed, immediate disposition of a cognizing subject towards some reality to be encountered. It would be an a priori structuring of the consciousness in which the subject constitutes his relation to a particular entity. This is called the framework of expectation. It is an outline to be filled in while the very encountering happens, and therefore it cannot be absolutely predetermined, though it is grounded on the subject, saying it, directing itself towards this reality and not any other thing, without any concrete conceptualization of the reality, yes, yet. So, if transcendence is claimed to be an unambiguous, unconditioned reality, the reality which with supra-subjective value, then how can one say that transcendence is experienced within a given framework of expectations of man? In other words, Is it not so that the experience of transcendence should be thought of as nothing else but what then Oberhammer calls the encounter with the beyond being, in which the beyond being becomes present purely as itself, without any condition, without any particular framework of how it is represented in the given religious tradition? Isn't it so that such an encounter actually excludes all differentiations, we would ask? If this would be the case, answers Oberhammer, one must also admit that to experience transcendence as true, one cannot anticipate the how of the experience. Quite the opposite, one must uncondition oneself from all conceptual knowledge of transcendence conveyed to him in the tradition, since, as it is generally assumed, the validity of this experience can neither rely on the spatial term of temporal conditioning of the subject nor be shaped by it. So how does he answer to this argument?
I'm sorry, since I'm a longer person. Yes, already, yes.
I'm about to finish.
Okay.
So to sum up the argument. The experience of transcendence always breaks open in acting towards the virtue, the target for acting, of each particular transcendental reaching out, performed in the anticipation of meaning, which demands mythization for each and every such an acting towards as the condition of its possibility. One cannot act towards and a priori principle of transcendence which was never arrived at by means of language. So, in that sense, Oberhammer's hermeneutics is also an existential hermeneutics of existential situation. And this is what is important, is the notion of mythization is prior to the event of this encounter, because it gives the subject, as Oberhammer says, a certain familiarity with the reality to be experienced, in which this familiarity is something to which the subject can entrust himself completely and without reservation to be experienced reality of the beyond being. And this complete trust and no lack of reservation is the condition of the encounter. So this is a sort of foreheading the reality which is not vouchsafed in any linguistic symbol, but is rather latent in the consciousness of the subject. It is a structural outline which allows the subject to build up in an anticipating attitude the welcoming organism, the innermost structure of the self, recognized by sixth sign, reaching out towards its target, which is the reality of the subject. Which is to be experienced. When it happens, the subject no longer is closed within his own subjectivity, he opens to words, or he reaches out to the target, to the virtue of the consciousness. That means that in the experience, the subject to a certain extent asserts and affirms what has been conveyed to him in the tradition, but in this affirmation, he also actualizes his own transcendental structure by the very fact of his opening up towards the infiniteness of the self-communicating openness of the beyond being. So, since I have to finish now, thank you very much.
Now, questions, please. Yes,
transcendence is being born into the tradition. I would say into the tradition, into the religious tradition. I think this is the basic point for Oberhammer. But you have the possibility of experiencing it. Whether you use it or not, it's your choice.
Whatever religion is.
Yes. And the second question was?
Since that knowledge be out there.
Well, no, I would say that, well, in his way of thinking about it, the place for experiencing transcendence is human beings.
What be out there?
Well, he's beyond a being in the sense of coming out of his closeness as a subject and becoming open in the horizon of the openness, which is creative to his transcendental subjectivity.
You mean that he can't create his own transcendence?
No, no, he doesn't say that. He says that the transcendence is actually the basis for his openness towards yoga. And, well, with this basic transcendental structure of the subject, the possibility of the encounter is there, within the horizon of this openness created by transcendence as such.
Very simple. Experience, then. Is it religious experience, or is it supposed to be a metaphysical experience?
No, it's an experience of one's own ontic conditioning, in the sense of what he says, according to his system. I'm just explaining the system. So according to his understanding of human consciousness, which should realize itself best in reaching out towards the other, because otherwise it is closed in its self-awareness. The very ability to open up towards the other is the ontic conditioning of the human consciousness. And in this realization, this becomes an experience of one's own being, yes.
I appreciate your presentation. But I do have a question whether this starting point, when you start with a closed subject, whether it doesn't necessarily bring a certain kind of arbitrariness. Because you never know when a human being starts sort of analyzing oneself, you never know whether this human being will actually arrive at the state of consciousness when he or she wants to be open to others. Wouldn't it be more fit or better to think of the human subject as a relational self?
Yes.
Instead of, but primarily relational self, and in terms of the narrative identity of the human self, so that, you know, the question of tradition, whether it be cultural tradition or religious tradition, I think we need to take it more seriously, perhaps, because what I sense from this proposal is kind of like a disembodied human self, or a search for a disembodied human self, stripped of historic tradition, stripped of one's narrative identity, and sort of esoteric searching in oneself, and then we arrive hopefully at some, you know, positive things, but there is no guarantee. So maybe the starting point itself is flawed, I would like to suggest.
Thank you. Thank you for this very inspirational remark. But I think, well, I think that Oberheimer's idea is much more simpler than my exposition of his idea, in the sense of how he understands this idea of the openness. It just is something which is present in us, because we converse with one another. So it's not the question of something which has to be proven, it's just an a priori conditioning that we come out of our closeness towards the other, for example, in our conversation right now. But on the other hand, this is not anything that has to happen every time for our consciousness. We can be closed because it's our, well, let's say, free will, whether we want to or not, be open actually in the experiencing of the other. So. But the possibility is there, and it is a presupposition which has got an ideological background, certainly. This presupposition is that the transcendentality is the condition for the openness of human consciousness. So this is there. But it's not a question of narrating oneself. It's a question of arriving at the realization. It's not a question of narrating, telling the story of oneself. It's a question of rather arriving at the realization that this possibility that is given by religion to you, which is the realization of the existence of transcendence, is something which you have to experience to yourself, within yourself. And how you experience it is framed by your own tradition, or needs to be framed by your own tradition, otherwise the danger arises.
Thank you. Now, the last short
question. So, yeah, it was just kind of, essentially, I think you just said it there, which is that it doesn't seem to mean that I can't have that historical horizon.
Yeah.
Just that it's within.
It is within this historical horizon as well. So, well, his trial was to combine both the episteme and the history and the experience within the transcendental. Yeah. Thank you very much.